Welcome to this lecture, Executive Knowledge Lecture on Topic 2, Paper 1 of the SFC Licensing Exams. This topic covers principles of relevant Hong Kong law and the new Companies Ordinance. We say new, it was 2014, but the materials, the official materials, still use new Companies Ordinance. And we'll come to that very shortly. I will emphasise the important points to help you understand the core material you need to know for the Paper 1 exam. Now, a copy of the study notes you see on the screen can be downloaded from the Executive Knowledge website under Resources for Paper 1. Now, while I will go over the main points in Topic 2 that you should be aware of to take on the exam, To prepare your short-term memory, I strongly recommend that you supplement this learning with question practice, and you can find over 500 practice questions for Paper 1 on Examinator.online, which is referred to at the bottom of each page of the study notes. Now, as you'll see from the overview in the first page, the first part of this topic looks at the outline of Hong Kong's legal system. And then, as I said a moment ago, we'll move on to the new Companies Ordinance. So, on page 2.2, under 1.1, source of Hong Kong laws. Well, common law goes back to the history, the colonial days of Hong Kong, and you'll see the 4 points that we've listed there. I'm not going to go into everything in depth. As I said, I'll highlight the main points that you need to know for the exam. Now, equity law or case law under 112 is where the courts, the judges, will make equitable decisions relating to particular cases. And we've listed there 4 remedies under equity law which apply to financial service industry, and we have seen this pop up in the exam. Anything that's got 4 bullet points is always attractive to an examiner. Injunctions, those are court orders that prohibit someone from doing something. The court just says, thou shalt not do. Specific performance, and that's where a court will order someone to carry out their part of the contract. Now, equitable rescission. When you rescind a contract, you get out of the contract. Equitable rescission is where the court will restore both parties to the original position before the contract was entered into. And rectification, that is where the court clarifies what the contract should say when perhaps it's not been properly recorded. Mercantile law, commercial law, business law, yes, it's there, but I wouldn't be too concerned about that. Primary and subsidiary legislation. For the exam, you must know the difference between the two. Now, primary legislation is written and passed by the government, and the name that we put to those are ordinances. So the Securities and Futures Ordinance is an example of primary legislation. Now, when the government wishes an expert body to write the legislation because they have the expertise, then they will delegate. The expert body will write the legislation, but the legislation is still passed by the government. And those are known as subsidiary legislation, and will have the word rules at the end of the title. So in our case, the SFC has written the financial resource rules, the client security rules, the client money rules. All of those are subsidiary legislation, and as such are the laws of Hong Kong. So primary and subsidiary legislation are both the laws of Hong Kong. If you breach them, you can be prosecuted. But they come from different sources. Moving along, in Hong Kong, the judiciary is independent of the government. Be aware of that. 2 categories of Hong Kong's law, criminal law and civil law. And that the difference is going to be very important when we get to topic 9, looking at market misconduct. But criminal law, you can go to jail. Level of proof is beyond reasonable doubt. Civil law, nope. You won't be going to jail, and the level of proof is balance of probabilities. Those points I would remember. contract law, law of agency, very standard, not regularly examined. Fiduciary, fiduciary relationship, be aware of the idea of good faith, trust, confidence. Now, the law of tort. A tort is a wrong. There's not necessarily a contract between two or more parties, but if someone is wronged, they can sue under the law of tort. The second bullet point there is relevant for our studies. Financial advisors who are negligent in giving advice may be exposed to actions under the law of tort. Employment law, rarely if ever examined. Now, I'd be aware of the system of law courts and tribunals in Hong Kong. As you see, the lowest court is the magistrates. We move up to district court, the high court. We have the Court of Appeal, Court of First Instance. They are exactly as they sound. And the highest court in Hong Kong is the Court of Final Appeal that the Chief Justice will sit on. Administrative tribunals, Market Misconduct Tribunal, Securities and Futures Appeals Tribunal are two examples, and they're set up as and when required. They're not technically the courts in Hong Kong. An arbitration, that is where an arbitrator will hear a dispute between two or more parties and help them to come to an agreement. Moving on to the companies legislation, as I said earlier, we refer to it as the new Companies Ordinance in this material. It came in 2014. It won't be long until they drop the new, but nevertheless, it's still there. Under 2.1, please be aware, a company is a separate legal entity. And these points you should be aware of. Legal entity distinct from members. A legal person can make contracts, take legal action, sue and be sued, own property and commit crime. Now, a legal person, what we're saying is the company is a legal person. And the company's perpetual succession only cease if dissolved. So that's the nature of companies. We've listed different types, private, public, guarantee company, and listed company. A listed company is a public company that has listed on the stock market. And then we have the details of what we have in the legislation with regard to companies, articles of association. We no longer have memorandum of understanding in Hong Kong, just the articles, which is the constitution of the company with regard to the relationship with members. Share capital, different categories of share capital, ordinary, preference, redeemable shares. You need to be aware of what these entail. Please note under ordinary shares, the fourth bullet point, from 30th April 2018, companies listed on the stock exchange in Hong Kong permitted to issue shares with different voting rights. That's weighted voting rights. And we'll cover that in more detail in topic 8. Other categories of shares, preference, redeemable, be aware of the points that are noted. Debentures. Debentures is an umbrella term for securitized debt, and it can be listed in Hong Kong. Fixed income security is a classic example. Meetings and procedures on page 2.10, the legislation lays out the meetings that a company should follow. The AGM is a classic example. And then we have the resolutions heavily examined. So be aware of the difference between a special resolution and an ordinary resolution. Under 272 there, we were told resolutions may be passed by circularization and signed by all members except for removal of auditors before their expiry of office and removal of directors before their end of term of office. And those cases require ordinary resolutions at general meeting. So what is the difference between a special resolution and an ordinary resolution? Special resolution must be passed by a super majority. That is at least 75% of members at a general meeting. And then there are other issues with regard to the special resolution. Whereas the ordinary resolution 274, a resolution passed by simple majority, more than 50% of those present voting at a shareholders meeting. So please be aware of the difference between the special and ordinary resolution. Powers of shareholders. Yes, shareholders have power. They have more power than the directors in certain areas. So the directors run the company, but under 281, there are specific powers that the members exercise. For example, the first one there, changes to articles of association and company name. It's the members that do that, not the directors. 282, 283 gives us details of what's in the legislation with regard to protection for minority shareholders. I would be aware of that generally. I wouldn't necessarily be following the detailed percentages. 29, directors and officers. Yes, the directors are tasked with running the company. Shadow directors, this is something specific in Hong Kong legislation. And a shadow director is someone that's not technically a director of a company, but gives instructions, influences the directors as to how they should act and how they should vote. And such shadow directors are recognized in the legislation. And they do have to comply with the law. A classic example of a shadow director is someone that's been banned from being a director of a company for whatever reason, but may well be a significant shareholder in the company. So even though they're technically not a director, they can influence the director and are still captured by the legislation. We list under 210 the qualifications, powers, the duties and liabilities of the directors. Be aware of those. Duties of directors. Directors are expected to act in the interests of the company, not in the interests of the shareholders, the employees, the suppliers, the customers. No, in the interests of the company. Now, if they act in the interests of the company, then hopefully they are acting in the interest of all other stakeholders. But that point has been examined. Liabilities of directors, that's a very polite way of saying that directors can be sued. In which situations? Well, there's four bullet points. If they breach their fiduciary duties, if they fail to act with reasonable care, skill and diligence, if they breach statutory duties, if they fail to prepare financial statements when they're required to do so. Financial arrangements with directors, top of page 2.14, well, directors cannot make a loan, or rather the company cannot make a loan to director or enter into any guarantee with regard to such loans. Audits and investigations, well, not surprisingly, first bullet point there, Hong Kong companies are required to be audited on an annual basis. Investigations may be ordered by the financial secretary, or the company may itself carry out an investigation. And then we've got some of the detail with regard to the appointment of inspectors by the financial secretary and duties to assist the inspector. We then come to the last subject under topic two, and that is liquidation of companies. Be aware, there are two types of liquidation: compulsory liquidation and voluntary liquidation. Compulsory liquidation is where a court of law will insist that a company is wound up, and it is the court that will appoint the liquidator, and we've listed a number of points that relate to that. Voluntary liquidation is where the directors of the company, the shareholders, the members, all agree time to liquidate the company, either because it's the right time to do so, and debts can be paid within 12 months, in which case it is a member's voluntary winding up, and that's highlighted the top page 2.16. If it's a financial issue, if debts cannot be paid within 12 months from the start of the winding up, then it will be a creditor's voluntary winding up. And that is where the creditors, the bondholders, the banks, people that are owed money, will appoint the liquidator and control the process. So the members, the shareholders, are not in as much control. Okay, that's a pretty quick run through topic two. You are not going to see a large number of questions in topic two. But when we do see questions appearing, they're often in the areas that I have paid particular attention to. So be aware of those, and remember, for question practice, go to examinator.online. Online.